and checking his partner. They were okay.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, who have joined us on this Dr. Fundi channel. Today, we're doing something very new on the Dr. Fundi channel. We are actually, you know, broadcasting an interview live with my guest, not virtually. You are gonna interact with us virtually, but we are actually sitting in one place with my guest. Today, we are having, you know, a virtual book launch. My guest, Dr. Ongwe Tlailane, is actually the author of this book, The New Me. It's a book that is targeted at the younger people. However, having read the book, the content is not only for younger people. The content is for everybody who still breathes oxygen. Even if you are 70 years old, there's stuff for you that you can get from this book. Even if you are an adolescent, there's something for you here. If you are somebody who has just started working, coming out of varsity, there's something for you. So this is actually a book that is good for everybody. So, but according to the author, her target audience, you know, was the young people. And her thinking there is that the young people are still moldable. They are still able to learn new things. They are still able to change. You know, there are some old dogs who actually do learn some new tricks. So I'm going to be encouraging her to actually make sure that this book reaches people beyond the definition of youth.
Yes. So
please, anyone who has joined us on Zoom, can you unmute? So can you mute, please, so that we are able to continue with the interview without any interference? So please, I'm asking everybody who's joined us to make sure that they are muted. All right, my name is Dr. Fundi Lenyati. I'm the host of this channel, the Dr. Fundi channel. We focus a lot on matters of health, but we are not limited to that. If there are other things that are interesting beyond the health space, we are able to go in and also share those, but we are largely a channel that focuses on matters of health. So let me introduce my guest today, Dr. Bongiwe Tlailane. She is now a publisher of two books, Her first book was called Just Be. All right, this is her first book, Just Be. But when somebody look, you know, when somebody looks at the new book, the A New Me, actually, that Just Be Authentic book makes up the first chapter of this book, the New Me. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. All right, so she is a qualified medical doctor, you know, but she also is a qualified, you know, person with a diploma in mental health from the College of Medicine of South Africa. She is considering going back to be a registrar in psychiatry because she has found passion in the area of mental health with special interest in child psychiatry. So we've got somebody here who does many things. She works full-time at the Military One Hospital. You know, she does ONG work. She does psychiatry work. She goes out and does outreach, you know, to inspire young people. So somebody who really, I actually don't know when she gets the time to do all of these things, but she's gonna tell us why she decided that this time around, she must come up with this very big book, A New Me. All right? So like I've said, she was born in Soweto, raised by both her parents, Thembani Joyce Nala, who was you know, somebody coming from the Zulu Kingdom, and also Jablani Nala, who's actually Swati. So she represents the Swatis and the Zulus, you know. So definitely somebody like that cannot be a tribalist. All right. Now, one interesting thing which takes us closer to the book that she has written is the fact that at an early age of 7 years old, she actually lost her dad. And that had a major impact in her life. She was left only with her mom, but at the age of 10, she actually also lost her mom, who was a professional nurse. So growing up from the age of 10, without your mom, without your dad, it's obviously a major, major impact, you know, for any child. So she has navigated her life from the age of 10, you know, without a mother and a father. But she was, you know, blessed to have an aunt and an uncle who became guardians to her and her siblings up until she was age 21, staying just, you know, adjacent to the house where the uncle and the aunt lived in Four Ways. All right. Now, one thing that made a lot of impact in her growing up was that her mother, you know, bought her a book about, you know, self-affirmation. Now, she's going to tell us a lot about what that book did in helping her to navigate the many challenges that she went through as she was growing up. And even in her book, she does mention that book, you know, about self-affirmation that she was given by her mom. So from age 21, she already was a property owner. You know, she bought a property in Midrand, a townhouse in Midrand, where she then stayed with her elder brother, who's about 2 years older than you,
one year
older than her. So, that's a little bit about our guest today. We will be talking about other interesting matters, you know, about our guest, you know, as we go on. But let me welcome you, Dr. B or Dr. Bongi or Dr. Bongiwe.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Nyati.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm excited about today. Thank you.
Yes. You've been very stressed, you know. Is everything going to go well? You know, what has been stressing you? Because I am so happy to host you here today.
It's my first interview, so new territory, you know, you come to the bit of nose.
Yeah, but at least your baby, the new me, you know, is now a reality.
Yes.
You know, somewhere in your book, you say from the age of 10, you already, you know, were enjoying writing.
Yes.
You know, at school when they were, you know, giving you some homework about creative writing, you were just getting so passionate about your writing. Perfect. And by the age of 18, you actually had a clear idea of the book that you wanted to write. Tell us a little bit about that.
You know, when I go to my outreach programs, I usually, before I tell them the story behind my passion and how I started writing.
Yeah.
There's a quote, a saying that I heard this week, that you don't become who you want to be, you become who you are. So writing has been my form of becoming who I am, because from a young age of 10, that was what I was excited about. That was my passion in school, what would get me excited.
Yes.
And even when I got a diary, that was the most fun time, being by myself, writing my dreams, writing my vision list, writing my wish list, writing how I feel, where it comes from, and trying to dissect where it comes from, why I'm feeling like that, my thoughts, and also summarizing by saying, what do I want, or how do I want to feel, and how am I going to make myself feel like that, yeah, or how am I going to change my thoughts? Right. So, your passion starts from what you enjoy from a very young age.
Yes.
Naturally so.
Yeah, and somewhere again in the book, you talk about the fact that it's so important for people to identify their passion, you know, very, very early on, you know. Yeah. All right. Now, I've gone through your book, just the first few chapters. But one thing I can say is that it's an easy read, right? Because I think it's important. People nowadays, the level of concentration is very, very low. So if one writes a book that requires one to, you know, focus a lot, they are not likely, you know, to have that person reading that book for long.
Yeah.
Now, so one of the things I picked up in the book is that it's very user-friendly. It's very, very relevant in terms of the content. Mm. It's really a life skills empowerment book. The graphics, you know, that are with each of the chapters, I mean, you've got about 46 lessons, you know, which one can say chapters. You've got about 46 of those, and in each, there's nice graphics that talk to the content. And the structure of the book itself is something that I haven't seen before. So we're gonna talk about those things, but let's just go back. You had a challenged, you know, growing up without both your biological parents from the age of 10. How did that affect you? Do you remember anything about the time when your dad was alive at the age of, 7?
You know, I think it makes me, my mom took me to boarding school from the age of 6.
Yes.
And that was the preparation for her knowing that she's chronically ill with arthritis and heart failure, and she might leave. So that already she was, you know, as a nurse, I felt like she was doing preventative.
Yeah.
It's like doing preventative medicine where you see that this might be a potential problem. How do you buffer it, or how do you
prepare?
So she actually prepared me mentally from the age of 6.
So you went to the boarding school at the age of 6?
Yes.
Most people would say that's child abuse, but actually it helped you to grow.
It helped me. It's what developed my independence.
Yeah.
And also when she did pass away when I was 10, I was already in a family setting,
yeah,
a sense of family. Besides my aunt and my uncle, the Mkhizes, which was a great upbringing and a privileged upbringing as well. But she taught me sense of self. From a very young age, because who are you with? You're with yourself most of the time.
Yeah.
So for me to be able to develop that, I never felt a sense of loneliness.
Yeah.
So that was a great tool that she told me.
She decided to buy a house that was just behind your uncle's house in Fourways.
Yes.
You know, in the township, they talk about back opposite.
Like, yeah.
Yeah, just back opposite. Yes. You know, she bought a house and made sure that by the time, you know, she checks out of this world, you are secure in a house with your brother.
Yes.
And your uncle and aunt are actually, you know, become your guardians to make sure that they help you guys up until the age of 21.
Yes.
Now, what challenges did you experience growing up without both of your parents? You know, we need to talk about this so that people can understand why the book, you know, because you are sharing those challenges, but just stuff that comes up, you know, in your head at this moment. Some of the experiences, you know, where other people, you know, would have mom picking them up or dad picking them up, you know, from school, and you didn't have mom, you didn't have dad, but at least you had, you know, the extended family to support you.
Yeah. I think one of the challenges is honestly making me think about something that, you know, never really feeling like I fit in.
Yes.
For example, you know, even if you are part of the family, but you're introduced as, you know, not, you're introduced as the cousins.
Yeah.
So then you feel a sense of, I fit in, but I don't really fit in. I think that's one of the major things that I battled with.
Yes.
And that's why I went to self-affirmations, affirming myself, feeling like, making myself feel like I belong and I fit in and I'm okay and I'm enough.
Yes.
And I'm valued and I'm loved.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So, your schooling, was it boarding school all the way?
Boarding school after grade 7.
Yeah.
And then afterwards I joined, that was at St. Dominican Convent in Belgravia. Then I joined my cousins who were at St. Teresa's Convent, Rosebank. That's high school.
Mm.
So we went to the same high school.
Okay.
After matric, yeah.
After matric.
Yeah.
Okay. So just tell me though, you and your brother, 1 year, you know, who's 1 year older than you, facing the world. What challenges came with that?
I think losing parents at a young age, it's difficult because besides your sense of identity, I think, you know, grief is something that you just don't get over overnight. It's something,
yes,
that you dwell, you know, like it's always there and you have to find a way to deal with it.
Yeah.
And one of the challenges I think is that my brother ended up using substances as an escape.
Yes.
He started smoking dacha, and I think that's maybe that he was depressed at that time and no one knew, and he was using it as an escape, and then it led him later on being diagnosed with having bipolar.
Yes.
So that precipitated mental challenges.
Yes. With your brother.
Yes.
Yes. So you had to grow up, even though you were younger than him, you know, in fact, you are younger than him because he's still alive, you know, but
yes,
you had to become the older one,
yes,
you know, so that his, you know, life can be, you know, you could help him, you know, navigate life.
Yeah.
All right. So you went and did medicine after you finished your high school. When did you think that you want to be a doctor? Has it got anything to do with the fact that one of the most influential people in your life, your mom, was a nurse?
Mm.
Yeah, just tell us a little bit about why you chose medicine.
My mom, her thesis when she was doing nursing was based on mental health.
Yes.
I loved the fact that she was a nurse and helping people, and that's what I've always wanted to do.
Yeah.
So I think it was a decision from a very young age, you know, and she'd always tell me that, you know, being a nurse or being a doctor, very secure jobs, you have, besides helping people, like your security in life is sorted, having jobs like that.
Yeah.
So it was just an obvious when I, interestingly enough, I don't think I even told you, when I got accepted to medicine, initially it was for BSc. So one of the lecturers advised me to do BCare, which is nursing. So I actually did do nursing for a year.
Oh,
and
okay.
Then I got distinctions, but then I was able to transition into medicine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you initially followed your mom's path into nursing.
Indirectly.
You know, yes, but you wanted to do medicine, but you excelled so much during that first year of BK that they said, you know what, why don't you get into the MPCHB?
So that's how it happened.
So that's Medunsa?
Medunsa, yes.
Yeah, it's now called the Sifako Mohato University.
And at that time it was called University of Limpopo when I finished, when I qualified.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So when they said to you, we think you should change to the medical stream, all right? What did it say to you?
That that's God's direction,
yeah,
and that I've got great potential.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. And you know, with you not having parents, did you get a scholarship, a bursary? You know, how did you fund your tertiary education?
Yes. Most of my education was, I started off with nurses, then I got a bursary, counting bursary, to finish off the rest.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when did you qualify as a medical doctor?
2006.
Yeah.
In 2006.
And at the time that you were doing medicine at Medunsa, was psychiatry something closer to your heart, or was ONG? Because I keep on seeing ONG, that is obstetrics and gynecology. I see psychiatry. It's like you confused between these two disciplines of medicine. Are these the disciplines that really excited you during your undergraduate years, or is something that you picked up afterwards?
Okay, so psychology, I mean, first year of psychology was like the most interesting of my subjects. And then obviously going into medicine and doing the final rotation, psychiatry was the most, I actually wanted to do psychiatry more than anything.
Yeah.
Especially with that background of my mom doing the thesis in mental health. But when I got to when I was doing my internship at Timbisa Hospital, my head of department convinced me to do gynecology. He said I was that good, you know, and I was just a good surgeon. So he comes, because like ops and gyne is one of those scary, more scary disciplines. Or intimidating disciplines.
Yeah.
So, but because I excelled so well in it in when I was at Timbisa Hospital as an intern, it came naturally again to do, and hence, that's why I wrote my primaries during my conserve, and usually it's done after conserve, because I was so interested in that.
So for people who have not done medicine, so you finished your undergraduate training, you became an intern, you became a community service doctor, and whilst you were a community service doctor, you decided, after you were convinced by your head of department, to go and do obstetrics and gynecology, you know, to be trained to become a specialist. You wrote the exams, which we call the primaries, where you do the basic medical courses. You passed them.
Yes.
Before you were even a registrar.
Yes.
You did. All right. And when that happened, you finish your home set, did you then go and become a registrar?
Yes, then I got a reg post through Steve Biko Hospital.
In Pretoria?
In Pretoria. So Steve Biko is linked to Kalafong Hospital.
Yeah.
So the rotations are between the two hospitals.
Yes. Mm. All right. So you became a specialist in training in obstetrics and gynecology, right? Between, Steve Biko Hospital and Kalafong.
Yes.
All right. How many years of a registrarship? Because I know that you dropped at a certain point.
So it's registrarship minimum is 4 years.
Yeah.
So I was in for about 2 years, then I took a break and I went back for another 2 years.
Yeah.
But then by the time I was going back, I think it was more of a feeling of, you know, finish what you started.
Yeah.
But it already felt like, you know what, I want to, after, if I, even if I finish this, I want to go to do psychiatry after this.
Okay. Now, I want us to talk about that.
Yeah.
So, because somebody you looked up to, your HOD, recommended that you do ONG, despite your earlier interest and fascination in medical school about psychiatry, you chose to listen to your HOD, right? Yes. Somewhere in the middle of your training, you were not getting fulfillment from the ONG training that you were undergoing, right? And then you ended up, doing what? You dropped from the ONG.
Yes, but I couldn't get away from it. Even when I moved out of a Red Post, wherever I went, they wanted me to do Obsangani. Because after I left Tibiko Tembisa, then I went to Tembo Memorial Hospital. I had to do Obsangani. I was there for about 2 years because I was waiting to transition to 1 mil. Yeah. 1 mil is closer to my house, so that's why I went. That was the preferred hospital.
Yeah.
Even when I got to 1 military hospital, they wanted me to do Obsangani, so I had to push my way into psychiatry. It took me about 1.5 years to eventually be in a psychiatric department.
Yeah.
But I'm still doing Obsangani calls because it's in such high demand. Like it's a very skilled and specialized department. So I'm still doing Obsangani calls as my overtime, but I'm in the psychiatric department during the year.
As what? As an
MO? As a medical officer.
As a medical officer. Yes. All right. So age 24, you are in the psychiatry space. After hours, you are in Oxford Guide.
Yes, but I love it. I love it. Yes, I love it.
All right. Okay.
The best of both worlds.
Beautiful. Beautiful. But how much of this interest in psychiatry has to do with the psycho-emotional challenges that you, your brother, went through, you know, and also some of the challenges as an adult, you know, that you went through? I mean, when we had our pre-meeting there during the week, you shared with me that, you know, life has not been on you. You know, when you passed and became an intern, already at that time, you actually had to make arrangements to sort out your property that was about to be repossessed.
Yes.
All right? Mm-hmm. Well, you had to do a lot of growing up. Mm-hmm. All right? So just tell us a little bit, you know, how much of your life experiences as a young adult actually confirmed your interests on matters of mental health?
From a very young age.
Yeah,
I think even in my living with my aunt and uncle in Fourways, I would be the one who organizes everyone in the house and making sure lunch is already, everyone is eating. I'd be the one who cook. Instead of playing outside, I want to cook and do all those things.
Yeah.
So and I think when my when I went to varsity and was staying with my brother and the mental challenges that he had. I had to step in and basically I've left psychiatry.
Yeah.
You know, making sure that he, you know, goes whichever hospital that he had to go to.
Yeah.
So I got to understand what psychiatry is, what a relapse is, the importance of taking medication.
Yeah.
I mean, I think I remember at some point I was so desperate, I even went to his drug dealers. I'm like, do not give him yaha or whatever. Do not.
Yeah.
So, you know, I became integrated into the biopsychosocial way of dealing with psychiatric issues.
Yeah.
You know, so it became second nature to me of how to deal with this, where to go, even if it seems, and the problem with things like bipolar is that, you know, you get the hypomanic stage, which someone will look at you like, no, this person is
it's just
okay.
Heavy.
Yeah, it's okay. Just a little bit happier.
Yeah.
But doesn't warrant admission.
Yeah.
And you have to now wait till there's a full manic episode. You have to go with police, get police to actually accompany you to the hospital. So things, challenges like that I had to face, but it's made me not be fearful of psychiatric patients and to see how you deal with them.
Okay.
Yes, how to deal with the situation.
You then decided to do a diploma in mental health.
Yes.
All right. Well, I'm asking these questions because I want our viewers, people who are going to be buying this book, to actually know that as much as you've done a lot of work in ONG, but your life experiences have drawn you to the world of mental health. I'm not just going to say world of psychiatry, the world of mental health in its broadness.
Yes.
I'm a family physician, all right? Mm-hmm. And the thing about biopsychosocial, you know, that holistic approach to patient care, it's something that, you know, is taught, you know, to all family physicians. Mm. Now, since 2001, that has been expanded to biopsychosocial spiritual. All right.
Yes.
You know, so that holistic approach. So you are saying to me, you've got interest on matters of mental health in that holistic sense,
yes.
You know, physical and mental, social, and also from a spiritual context.
Yes.
All right. So you passed your diploma with the College of Medicine of South Africa, right?
Correct.
Now you are sort of not sure. And there's a part of you that wants to go and become a registrar, okay? Another 4 years of hectic, you know, reading and working in hospital. Mm. But there's also something that is quietly telling you that maybe you are called to do something broader than, you know, the specialty of psychiatry, but with psychiatry as a foundation. Talk to me about that, because during the week we talked about that.
You know, the fact that I can be a doctor and an author at the same time and release such, I feel like such, this is my work of art.
Yeah.
Means there's a lot of room. Psychiatry is not just like doctor-patient care, but we are all either impacted or affected or by mental health. So if I can reach and do my outreach programs as well, I've seen that there's a great need to really go out there and educate everyone about mental health, not just in a psychiatric setting.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we were speaking about, you know, a foundation. And for me, that seems so big because I'm a doctor.
Yeah.
These other things are so big for me. But the fact that I could accomplish this means there is a lot of room and space to really teach and or to make mental health
to make
a bigger impact.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't know how, but
it's something that you are still thinking about.
Yes, yeah, I'm thinking
about. All right, whether to go back and specialize, you know, or to actually add other skills that may help you to have a much broader impact, you know, on matters of mental health. I mean, in South Africa, as a country, we spend less than 5% of the total annual healthcare budget on mental health. Mm-hmm. Yet the need for mental health services, access to mental health is so great. Just about a week or two ago, our president actually focused on this issue. You know, the Minister of Health, Dr. Joe Patha, focused on the issue of mental health, the challenges of lack of access. So it starts from, you know, education, health promotion from a mental health point of view, to early, you know, a diagnosis of people with mental health challenges, to ensuring, you know, a proper access to treatment, adherence to treatment, and all the way, you know, before people complicate from these major mental illnesses, like, you know, major depression, you know, bipolar mood disorder, you know, schizophrenia, anxiety disorders, eating disorders, substance abuse, which is a big problem. Yes. You know, so for me, it's a bigger, you know, there's a bigger need in that area for the country. I'm not saying there's no bigger need in ONG, but I also am aware that a number of ONG specialists, you know, or people who were considered because of the levels of litigation, people who are suing doctors, the lawyers who are making a lot of money from suing doctors, a lot of people are reconsidering, you know, that direction, because you now have to spend about 750 to a million just on your medical insurance. Because of the level of claims. But I mean, if that's your calling, then that's it. So anyway, Doc, let's get to your book. We've spent the last 30 minutes just talking about you, but I want us to talk about the book, because really this is the book launch. So let's start talking about the book, all right? Now, in this book, let's start with the covering. All right, let's start with the covering. You've got the title, A New Me. Mm-hmm. All right. Why a new me?
And my keys.
What influenced you to choose this? Again, as I was reading in the book, I saw that this is like a shortening. It says, what do you call it now? Reflections on a new, of a new me.
Yes.
All right. Mm-hmm. So talk to me about that title.
Because I think I've been doing self-reflection, introspection from a very young age, because I've always written from the age of 10. So a new me, the more you introspect or you reflect, the more you see change in your life.
Yeah.
So you do actually become a new me. The more you incorporate your life lessons, the more you grow, you do become a new me. You transform from the inside out.
But I think there's an assumption there. That when you reflect, you take seriously that which you get to know through your reflections. Because sometimes you reflect and you don't like that, you know, the picture that you see. All right?
Mm-hmm.
But other people, you actually learn from that which the insights that you get from reflection.
Yes.
And become a better version of yourself.
Yes. Yes.
All right. So you can reflect and do nothing about it.
Yeah.
Or you can reflect with a view to becoming a better person.
Yes.
So you are the kind of person who reflects a lot because you believe in ongoing development, in becoming a better version of yourself.
Yes.
Right? Okay, so that's one of the things. So the A New Me is actually reflections of a new me,
yes.
All right? Mm-hmm. Now, the target, who did you write this book for, you know? Well, we need to interest the people who are following us on social media, people who are actually with us here on Zoom. We need to interest them, you know, to make sure that they buy this book for themselves, but also give it as a gift. You know, there's Christmas coming up in less than 2 months from now. So people will be looking for ideas, you know, of valuable gifts, and having read your book, this is definitely one investment that I think every family in South Africa should actually make, because whilst the content is directed to adolescents, teenagers and young adults, but I found the content one of the lessons in the book, the first lesson, is about authenticity.
Mm.
How many people of my age, you know, I'm in the early 50s now, people who are in their 60s who are still not in touch with their authentic selves? You see,
yeah.
So yes, it's good to teach the younger ones about being authentic from the beginning, because fake doesn't last, and fake will never reach, you know, the highest level of what they were designed to be.
Yes.
All right. So I mean that lesson, which we are going to talk about, is not just for young people.
That's,
you know, being authentic.
Yes.
You get me.
And being authentic means being true to who you really are.
Yes.
And all of us, you know, from teenager to adults, we're all still discovering who we truly are.
Yes.
You know, so
yes.
it's actually a family book.
That's what I'm saying.
A family book.
This is a family book.
Yeah.
Yes, it will help you as a parent to give this to your you know, to your son or daughter who's still growing up, because it's a lot of good things, but also to give to nieces and nephews, but also read it yourself,
yeah,
as an adult.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Right. So this book, I can describe it as a motivational, self-help, interactive life guide kind of book.
Yes.
Which, like I said, everybody should have it in their homes.
The main inspiration for the book is,
yeah,
being a parent myself. You know, being a parent, to my babies. I don't like calling them my babies.
Well, to you as a parent, they will always be my babies. You know, they may not like it, but the truth is, when you see them, you still remember the day you first saw them and you held them in your arms. Yeah.
You know, my 13-year-old Hweti.
Yeah.
Meaning champ.
Yeah.
My 6-year-old daughter Temba, I mean, she actually got my mom's name. So they have been, I reference them a lot because if, you know, I wanted it to be an everyday book about everyday life. So I reference them a lot about, and I've learned a lot from them and they've learned a lot from me. So it's a teach and learn experience being parents. So I think they really, honestly, my son being a teenager was the greatest influence of me writing for teenagers because I saw when I was for his test, when I was able to summarize it in a way that he got it. So, and I thought, how, if I've got that skill of being able to interpret large information in a way that can be understood simply, then you transfer that energy into what I know writing.
All right. So let's get to the purpose of writing this book. You know, as I was reading through, just at the beginning, and you were talking about the intended benefits, you know, the intended benefits, you know, for somebody who's reading this book. Broadly talks about empowering people on the EQ side, on the emotional intelligence side.
Yes.
All right. Self-awareness, issues of self-regulation, you know, issues of empathy, issues of social and interpersonal skills. Something that we don't really focus on. We focus a lot on the intellectual intelligence, the IQ, you know, trying to get our kids to get those straight A's and stuff. But sometimes just getting the straight A's is not enough. You could have your straight A's and still not be successful in life because the issues of EQ, you know, emotional intelligence, social intelligence, have not been addressed, and even spiritual IQ as well.
That's true.
You know?
Yeah.
So I saw that you said you want to encourage children to discover and accept their uniqueness and develop a positive, you know, self-image.
Yes.
All right? So when people read this book, you want to help them to achieve that, right? You said you want people to develop self-belief and self-discovery of their unique gifts and talents, all right? You also said you wanted them to know more about, you know, this concept of empathy, the ability to put yourself in one's shoes and see things from their point of view. All right, which is not something that many kids know how to do, you know, with the level of bullying that we see out there, you know, then it is so important that, you know, kids are taught these EQ skills.
Yes, from a young age.
You know, because, you know, a few months ago, there's a kid in Limpopo who was bullied so much at school, all right, and a few days later committed suicide from the trauma of being bullied. What it tells you is that those kids who were doing this, certainly they don't have the ability to see things from the side, you know, from the side of the child. All right? And which is a problem, you know, which is a problem. So developing kids with empathy, you know, very, 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 very important. All right?
Yeah.
So, Doc, now, before you went in and talked about the lessons, there's about 42 lessons or chapters in this book, right? But you decided to put a disclaimer, all right? You decided to put a disclaimer. I just want you to tell me why you chose to put that disclaimer.
Because this is not a formula. It's not a formula book. If you do this, your life will be perfect.
Yeah.
And also, there's still the importance of consulting, yes, consulting a doctor, a psychologist, a social worker for issues of mental health. It's important, the professionalism of it, yes, it's important to consult, yes, so that you can get the required help.
Yes. So you thought it's important. It's a very good book. It's all the experiences that you've accumulated to date, but it's not a substitute,
yes,
to not going to see your family doctor,
yes,
your clinical social worker, or your clinical psychologist. Mm. But it would certainly help, you know, in being able to navigate that challenge, yes, you know, if you are going through issues of mental health.
Yes, because you're not always, you know, a session with a psychologist or a doctor is more than, it's about 2 hours.
Yes.
But you're with yourself the rest of the time.
Yes.
How do you help yourself, you know, when you are with yourself at home and you're having these disturbing emotions and thoughts?
Yeah.
So it's more of a tool to help, but it's not a solution.
Yes.
It's not the solution.
Yeah. Right. Now, when you were looking at the audience and you said the young people, why the young people? As the key people that you wanted this book to be, you know, focused on?
Because when you are young, that's when your personality is developing. Mm. That's when everything that happens to you, your environment, your influences you.
Yeah.
Children approach the world as to how they are culturally brought up as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, as much as we can diagnose something like borderline personality disorder, yeah, when a patient is 18 years old, they don't wake up being with that personality. It, yes, is developed. Yeah. And that's why even in the book, I put younger kids on purpose,
yeah,
and then teenagers in the cover, because you don't just wake up a teenager. You,
yes,
there are certain things that happen to you in life that shape, mm, you.
So there, in the front on the cover, you've got the kids,
yes,
right? The younger ones.
Yes.
Then above them, you've got like teenagers and adolescents.
Yes.
So you're actually showing that at various stages of growth, kids do need to be assisted,
yes,
to develop some of these critical life skills,
yes,
long before they become adults.
Yes, definitely.
All right. So, Doc, there is a question here from Tabani Ngwanyana. All right. Hi, Dr. Nyati. This is Dr. Tabani Ngwanyana, classmate and friend of Dr. Ngala. My question is, what advice can Dr. Ngala give to teens who are growing up without role models and therefore lack guidance? So I think answer this colleague, because this is again stuff that is not taught at medical school. Mm. You know, this is about life skills. It's about application of what you learned at medical school and elsewhere to say we need to empower these teams. Now, you've been doing a lot of outreach. What have you picked up? You've even gone to some of the correctional facilities,
yes,
to talk to kids who've been on the wrong side of the law. So the question from Dr. Ngwanyana is, when kids don't have role models, you know, what should they do? I know there's an answer in your book, because again, in your book, you did talk about, you know, people that have inspired you, you know, the teachers,
yes,
Oprah, Bishop T.D. James, Joyce Meyer, Joel Osteen, Maya Angelou, Iyanla Van Zandt, and even Trevor Noah, right? Mm-hmm. So the question is, if somebody doesn't have a role model, and a role model, I think it doesn't have to be somebody in the immediate facility, because when you look at these people that have inspired you, some of these people are actually, you know, in, yeah, America, yeah, they don't even know you, but through how they present their lives and write about their lives and share about their lives, they touch you. So please answer that question from Dr. Ngwanyana.
Hi, Tabani. Thank you for joining us. You know, I think anyone can adopt a role model.
Yeah.
Anyone can adopt a role model.
And you don't need their consent.
You don't need their consent. You know, in the book, I write about spending about 30 minutes a day where you are listening to or watching something in very inspirational, whether it's a book or a program or a religious program. That's where I found my inspiration.
Yeah.
You know, so, and also, how do you learn to be your own role model? You self-affirm.
Yeah.
I am this, I am that, I am
capable. So how did you self-affirm?
So how did I self-affirm? You know, my mom would put a twist to it and say, you must say, thank you, God, that I am smart.
Yeah.
Because then you don't...
I am creative.
I am creative.
I'm not just a doctor who, you know, I can do other things on top of being a doctor. And nothing wrong with you being a doctor. Nothing wrong. Absolutely nothing wrong. But I'm just saying, for you, it's a differentiator.
And
the fact that over and above having that degree, you were able to actually discover something from, you know, your brain that is creative, which is the book that we are showcasing today.
And from a very young age.
Yeah.
So if you start that from a very young age, self-affirming, then it becomes a part of you to create your destiny or to create who you are.
Yeah.
I mean, and I think life or the universe will open pathways to that, because when I've also been a person who's always wanted to work. When I was on holidays, I'd work.
Yeah.
So I'd go to CNA and then I discovered some of these books from these role models.
Please, can you mute CD Mashoko? Please, can you mute? We are getting some interference there. Thank you very much. In the book, you talk about the fact that during school work, you used to work at the CNA stores.
Yes.
And that actually became an opportunity for you to explore some of these books that have now shaped the way you see the world.
Definitely.
Just tell us a little bit about that. Because other kids are like, why should I work? You know, or you really look at that opportunity of working as something that, you know, is denying them of the time to go and play with other kids. But for you, you use that to get pocket money,
yes,
but also you use that to empower your mind. Just talk to us about that. Yeah,
it goes back to what my mom was teaching me from a very young age, to be independent.
Yeah.
So when you work during school holidays, you create your own independence because you have extra cash.
Yeah.
You also meet other people. You get to do different activities. So it builds you. It really builds you. It's not. So it's all about how perception.
Yeah.
Because that's, for me, that was the fun thing that I loved to do when I was during school holidays.
Yeah.
And I was able to read books that I probably couldn't even afford buying, but I would, because I was working in CNA, I got exposed to like a world of such amazing motivational, inspirational books.
Yeah.
My first book I ever read was Gary Zukav's The Seat of the Soul.
At CNA.
CNA, yes. So, and then I discovered true, there's so much more than this bubble of a life that we live.
Yes.
And that books can help you to escape and to see life differently and to explore different places while you are just right here in your little world.
Right. So there's a comment on Facebook from Nthika Nkosi. Please, can you mute? Deborah Mosiki, can you please? Good. Deborah Musegi, thank you very much. All right, Nzika Mkosi says, what an amazing, inspiring woman. I can't imagine life without parents at such a young age. Who was her inspiration to keep going and not be like her brother who opted to use substances? I hope her brother has bounced back from the traumatic experience. Can you comment on this comment that came via our Facebook page from Nthika Nkosi?
Okay, who was my inspiration?
Yeah, who, she can't imagine the life without parents at such a young age. Who was your inspiration to keep going and not, end up escaping to things that could be destructive?
My early childhood schooling, I went to St. Dominican Convent. From a very young age, St. Dominican was Catholic.
Mm.
And I think a lot of I particularly enjoyed the praise and worship. So I think I would go back to that space of really seeking a deeper relationship with God.
Yeah.
And I think that was the most empowering thing for me to be able to grapple and deal with whatever I'm going through, even if it's with tears at some point. But
yeah.
I had that hope that everything will all work out because we are all part of God's plan. Interestingly, is that I remember just before my mom's house got sold, there was someone came to the house and they said the verse, "For I know the plans for your future." And then I went to church, and it was written at the back of the seat that I was sitting behind at the back of the seat that I was sitting on. And they said, "I know the plans for your future." Mm. Then I saw it on a billboard. So
that's
for me,
actually me to deny you.
Yes. So for me, like, I felt that
that's my realistic.
Really,
So
that was also my very, very comforting at that moment.
Yeah.
Because then I felt that, you know, God sent me messages in different
ways.
All right. And confirmation. Yeah.
All right. So I think what you are saying is your grounding in spirituality gave you faith.
Yes.
Gave you hope of a better future.
Yes.
All right. So whilst you did go through life challenges, you did find grounding in your spirituality. Now, my question then is, this grounding in spirituality, is it something that started, that was instilled in you by one of the parents before, God, took them? Or is it something that you learned, as we're being, looked after by your guardians, that is your uncle and aunt?
From early childhood.
Yeah.
You know, my mom would do this, not really a ritual, but she would have these Bible verses that she had.
Yeah.
And we used to go to Mahon Mission in Deep Kloof.
Yeah.
And Sunday school. It was where it started. I mean, we had to read these Bible verses.
Yeah.
We would pray together. But I also do that with my kids, where we read a Bible verse in the morning before they go to school. So it was from very early childhood, before even my mom passed away.
Yeah.
You know, and she always would tell me that God and your education are the most important things, because no one can ever take that away from you. Whatever you can lose, but God and education are the most important
things. So now that you are approaching the 4-0, because in the book you keep on saying I'm approaching the age of 4-0. So now that you've got that experience of almost 4 decades of life, do you still feel the grounding that your mom talked about, God and education, are actually the way to give somebody a better future?
Definitely. That's why even when I transitioned from gynae to psychiatry, the first thing within, 9 months or within a couple of months of getting into psychiatry, I had to get a diploma.
Yeah.
You know, so education is lifelong. You cannot, and especially in medicine, you learn that you need to still upgrade with articles, the next information.
Continuing so medical education.
Continuous learning is very important.
All right.
Yes.
Now, let's get back to the book.
Yes.
So at the beginning, in your introduction, you say you're focusing on the younger people, because a number of kids experience early childhood difficulties or traumas, sometimes even before they are conscious about those experiences.
Yes.
All right. And also, you are saying the long-term complications, the long-term complications of those early childhood traumas in terms of personality and the view of life, can be quite devastating if not dealt with much earlier.
Mm-hmm.
You go on to say it's therefore important that kids who have gone through a situation in their early life are actually assisted they are recognized and they are assisted to find solutions to healing and prevent devastation. Just tell me about that part. Any recognition of kids who are struggling with some life issues, because in your view, if those issues are dealt with much earlier, there's a better chance that they will come up with minimal impact of those things if they've been effectively dealt with.
I mean, I think in most of the time, kids probably would be presented to a psychiatric or pediatric setting only if they have attention problems.
Attention deficit issues, yeah.
But usually for other behavioral problems, sometimes it takes a while for parents to think or to see that, you know, that's the route to go to get professional help, because, you know, from a very young age, there can be chemical imbalance.
Yeah.
And seeking, getting medication will help balance those things.
Yeah.
Like, as you've seen with COVID, kids are going through a lot
very
of
difficult
very
yeah.
difficult times.
Yeah.
Children have lost parents,
yeah.
Or caregivers, even grandparents. So
yeah.
Loss of income in the household. So there have been a lot of devastating things that have been happening. And also this whole homeschooling. Some children
yeah.
couldn't handle it.
Yeah.
So there's been a lot of changes. And I think when we tackle these issues whilst they're going through the changes,
yes.
it's better than waiting for 18 years old or older.
Yeah.
You know, yeah.
In your book, you say you embraced your own life experiences, especially the ones that almost broke you. Now, most people would, you know, say, but why? Why is she saying she's embracing the experiences that were the worst?
Because it gives you the ability to be able to adapt.
Mm.
And that's what's important.
And test your resilience.
Yes, it's important to be able to adapt. And because then if you change your perception and you look at things in a positive, it's important to always look at things in a positive light.
Yeah.
Yeah, it will determine the outcome.
All right. So, and you're saying you went through many personal life challenges, but you have decided to strip yourself naked, you know, to strip yourself naked to actually use your own life experiences to empower others. I don't think that's an easy thing to do. Most people tend to want to keep, especially the bad side of things that have happened within and not share them. But for you, you were courageous enough in this book to actually decide, you know what, I am going to bear it all for the benefit of others. Is it part of your enlightenment? Is it part of discovery of your life purpose?
Yes, it's part of being authentic.
Hmm.
Because people will relate to you on a deeper level if you're able to say, I'm a doctor, but I've also been, because, you know, we put each other in boxes.
Yeah.
Our doctor never has problems. Life is perfect.
Yeah.
We all at some point in our lives have challenges and problems.
Yeah.
So if you can reach people from a deeper level and say, look at me, I don't even label myself as an orphan because I'm God ordained.
Yeah.
Orphan for me, I feel like comes with pity. That's why I use the word shame.
Yes.
But I was born for a purpose which should be fulfilled, whether my parents, which is fulfilled, whether my parents were there or not from a young age. It's the same for all of us.
So what triggered you to discover that authentic self and wisdom? Because that's what you say. You say you have discovered your authentic self and wisdom. That's what you say in the intro of your book. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think,
and you found that you are a teacher. You actually get a kick from teaching, from sharing.
Yes, it goes back to me saying being a parent.
Yeah.
Being a parent and being involved with my kids. I always say before my kids learn anything from school, they've learned from me, learning how to be, especially developmental stages. Obviously, my son now is more independent.
Yeah.
But, you know, my daughter is 6 now. So she is in the stage where she's learning how to read. Her numbers and all that. So from the early developmental stage with my kids, I loved being involved and figuring out how to teach the timetable, figuring out how to, for them to, you know, remember things like how we did when I was growing up, mind maps and all those things.
Mm.
Those are the things I learned in boarding school. My mom never taught, she only saw reports. She was never really involved in the teaching part. But I find that now we have to be, as parents, we are more involved in also the teaching part with that with our kids, which is which brought a lot of excitement to me.
Yeah. Mm. So you talk a lot about life purpose. Have you discovered your life purpose?
Everything that I'm doing is my life purpose.
Can you tell me? Because remember, this is what you're sharing this in the book about different things, but being aligned to why you are here on earth. So I'm asking you, in a simple way, do you know or do you now have insights about why this person called Dr. B came here on earth? They stripped her of her parents by the age of 10. She's now 40, and she's actually about to explode and impact the world.
I think, you know, the gift of encouraging and motivating. That's my passion. The gift of encouraging and motivating others to be the best version of themselves or to be true to who they are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Then you touched something about generational curses. And the need to break those and do things differently so that this generation doesn't suffer from issues that come from poor decisions from generations before. Just talk to us about that.
I mean, that's why I'm saying this book is about deeper conversations with teenagers.
Yeah.
Because I think as families, you know, that we grew up and there's certain things maybe that weren't discussed or were taboo or that we couldn't really understand the concepts of why this is happening.
Yeah.
And children were not involved in the decision making or at least informed of what's happening.
Yeah.
Next thing, the dad is gone. We don't know why dad is gone. You know, people even battle with things of their identity.
Yeah.
Of their settings.
Yeah.
And now with the introduction of blended families and not knowing who their dad was, now having to call someone else that, you know, things that I feel it's important for us to have deeper conversations so that children understand what they're going through. And I think that's what's gonna break generational curses, knowledge and doing things differently.
Yes.
That's what I think.
Okay. So you talk about the laws of the universe, right?
Yeah.
I enjoyed that part, by the way.
Okay.
Where you were talking about the laws of the universe, the pattern and the timing, the earth that's positioned well-resourced to sustain your life, the fact that you are here on earth is not an accident. You were born for a purpose. And that purpose is to make sure that you live a life of significance. And that life of significance is not necessarily for your own benefit, but is for you to make a difference to the others.
Yes.
Talk to me about that. That's powerful, eh?
I think it goes back to what I always emphasize, and that's why I have a gratitude standing column, no matter what's happening, even if it can be the worst Sunday or bad things are happening, or you know, I always have a gratitude Sunday column on my Facebook and Instagram because I feel like it keeps me grounded. It's
counting your blessings.
Counting your blessings.
Yeah.
Or being grateful for there's always something to be grateful for.
Yes,
there's always something to be grateful for.
You know, it's lesson number two in your book, was lesson number one is about being authentic. Right?
Yes.
You know, being relevant, being present, being real, setting boundaries, being able to say no at times to things that are not for you, being balanced, being moldable, being reliable, being humble, and being yourself, being strong, because we were built to be able to deal with whatever that life throws at us. You know, being fun, you know, discovery of fun. That's your first lesson about being authentic.
Yes.
Now, you are talking to us about the second lesson in your book, which is about gratitude, right? You say every Sunday you have a gratitude post.
Mm.
You go on in your book to actually define, you know, what gratitude means to you, the spirit of gratitude. You talk about being thankful, showing appreciation and returning, you know, the kindness, you know, the gratitude, which is doing good. Talk to us about this. Was yes, I'm your Facebook friend, and every Sunday I do go and check. What are you grateful? You know, what are you grateful for? You know, this spirit of gratitude. Yeah,
it goes back to the really the law of attraction. The more grateful you are, the more, you know, the universe presents you with more things to be grateful for.
Yeah.
And the more you want to be grumpy and grumble about stuff, the more it seems like there's more to complain about.
Yeah.
So I think like going back to just being, having a positive attitude about everything, seeing the positive in whatever situation.
Yeah.
And changing your mindset and your perception. It's just, it lifts your mood.
Yeah.
It just makes your day brighter.
Yeah.
And it starts from within, no matter what anyone else is doing or the circumstances outside. It all starts from within.
Yes. Yeah. Now there's a comment here, Doc, from CD2. All right. This is so great, Dr. Bongiwe. Congratulations.
Thank you, TD. Thank you.
That thank you doesn't seem to have enough energy.
I appreciate that. Thank you, TD. Exciting. Thank you.
We need to get that energy. You know, these people need to go and buy this book. So the energy must be there, Doc. Thank you for joining us, by the way. All right. So when you're talking about gratitude, you say the road to self-nurturing, kindness, and self-healing. So you're saying gratitude is a road to self-nurturing, kindness, and self-healing. It's the best way to change your view of a situation.
Yes.
Whatever situation that is thrown at you, you have a choice.
Yes.
All right? And you can choose to be a victim, or you can choose to look at the gift that bad situation is bringing, because all situations, they come bearing gifts.
I always say to my kids, there's no such thing as bad news.
Mm.
Because everything is presenting itself with a way of looking at things or a way of doing things differently. So even what I went through, I wouldn't have been able to be able to be an author and write these books with the depth that I did if I didn't go through those experiences.
Yes.
So everything worked out for my greater good.
Yes. You know? So actually, your experiences were preparing you for your greater life purpose.
Yes.
And you wouldn't be authentic as a writer if you theorized about some of these experiences. So your experiences have actually given you authenticity.
Yes.
They've given you firsthand experience of the things that you are talking about, right?
Mm.
So actually, that's wealth, that's wisdom. Yes. Because if you choose to learn from those experiences, you gain wisdom. And it is that wisdom that's what I make people to buy this book.
Correct.
Because by sharing your testimonies of life, and by the way, all of us, we go through stuff, you know?
We all go through stuff.
Yes. And it's important that we actually own up to those situations, whether they are caused by us or they are caused by somebody else to us.
Mm-hmm.
But own them up. See what is the lesson.
Yes, definitely.
Right. So you say for you, you always choose when you are in a situation, good or bad, to see the positive, the silver linings. All right. And you actually have been one of those people who are practicing returning kindness, which is part of altruism, doing stuff for others without expecting gain. And in fact, you've sacrificed a lot of your family resources doing stuff for others. And that's what altruism is all about, or philanthropy, using what you have, resources, money, or time, or networks, or something else that will brighten somebody else's day. And at the time you're doing that, there's nothing that you expect, you know, from that person.
Yes.
All right, so that's this second lesson in your book. I'm not going to tell them everything because we want them to go buy the book, right?
Okay.
All right, so that's the second lesson. There's 42 of these life lessons.
Yes.
You know, and then you say you are in a habit of thank you.
Okay.
As part of your gratitude.
Yes.
You are in a habit of always saying, thank you, God, thank you this, thank you that, you know. Actually, you challenge people to always practice the 10 things, you know, to say, to be thankful for, right?
Mm-hmm.
In your Facebook and other social media, you always challenge people in their gratitude journal.
Even my patients.
Even your patients.
Yes, I ask them, what are they grateful for? These five things they're grateful for before we start a session.
Yeah.
So that we get used to the habit of just...
You don't think this doctor is cuckoo.
And then if they can't mention two things, I say, oh no, you must be very depressed. You can't even get to two, you know?
Yeah.
That means you're very, very depressed.
You know, the human mind is wired to focus on negatives, such that if you say, write 10 positive things in your life and 10 negative things in your life, you are more likely to fill up the things that are not going well in your life rather than the things that are, the fact that you woke up, you can breathe spontaneously, you don't need a machine to do that, the fact that you've got a roof over your head, the fact that you were able to have breakfast this morning, the fact that you were able to come here for us to try and inspire other people through your book. So there's so much.
There's a lot to be grateful for.
And for each one of us, you know, so it's a good habit.
Then I always say, try not to repeat the same things like my house, my family, my parents, because then you'll start looking at the little things like, you know, and the new pair of shoes I got, so being able to just stay in a bit longer this morning.
Yeah.
So you start looking at the little things that we often take for granted, which is great.
Now,
the
third lesson, you say enlightenment, right? I'm not going to share all of these 42 because people must have a reason to buy the book, right? Enlightenment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you start that one with a quote from T.D. Jakes, Bishop T.D. Jakes. You say, if you only define yourself by what others say about you, you will never find yourself and therefore can never be yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You will be living under the curse of the ignorance of people who did not understand the prophecy that was over your life. This is a quote from T.D. Jakes. Tell us about this quote. It was when you start this third lesson, enlightenment, you start with this quote.
Sure. I think, you know, as much as we say we are determined by our genes, our environment, and what people think of us.
Yeah.
So this is about moving away from that mindset and saying, how do I see myself?
Yeah.
Because as long as you see yourself under the shadow of those three wings, your genes, where you come from, and what people think of you, you might not even be able to reach your fullest potential.
Yeah.
You know, if I had to go by that, my genes, my environment, what people think, I wouldn't be where I am today.
Yeah.
So I think it's important to do things that do build you
yes.
so that you can move, which is part of breaking generation. You move away from that, from those, the limitations.
Yes.
Physical and emotional limitations.
Yes.
To you being who, to being your, the best version of yourself.
Right.
Mm.
So you talk about enlightenment, living life consciously, becoming more observant of what you're supposed to learn in all situations, all right? And that to me is what they call you know, mindfulness, you know, being present, being present, you know, asking yourself, are you enjoying the journey? Are you fulfilled? And on Wednesday, when we had our pre-meeting here, I asked you a question. And my question was, from everything that you've told me about yourself and what gives you a kick, do you think that will be fulfilled when you actually get your fellowship in psychiatry. And you actually did not give me an answer, but it made you think,
yeah.
Right? So the question here, and it's a question from your own lesson, are you fulfilled? And when I asked you, what is something that you can wake up at 1 a.m., 2 a.m. and do without any question? And it was about sharing, you know, your life experiences, motivating and inspiring others. Mm. And then I said to you, does that mean if that is what motivates you, is it dependent on you getting the fellowship or not? And your answer was not necessarily.
Yes.
All right. So you are talking here about enlightenment, which is self-discovery, self-awareness, and environmental awareness. All right.
Yes.
You talk about being aware of your past. Now, your past has been very challenged.
Mm.
All right. Your past has been very challenged, but that's what God allowed you to go through, because he had a bigger plan for you to be able to, you know, empower others. And so you say you are the sum total of all your experiences,
yes,
to date,
yes,
right? Good and bad.
Yes.
All the experiences you've accumulated in life to date actually make you the person you are. Now, let me ask people who have connected with us if they've got any comments or questions, whether you're on Facebook or on YouTube or even here on Zoom. We've got about 17 people who joined us, 16 people joined us here. Please use the chat option and either say a comment directed to Dr. B or a question that she can answer. We've got about 15 more minutes to go. So you talk about the past traumas,
yeah,
and how they affect the current emotional growth. In your situation, are there any things that you can identify and say that and that definitely did affect me, even though I'm now an adult who's just beginning life at 40? But that and that did affect the way I see the world. It's one of my weaknesses, my area of, you know, of development, to address this or that.
I think when 2019, actually what also inspired me to write the books was that I went through a depression, because I think, you know, as much as you can be a strong person, we all have a breaking point.
Mm.
So I think the accumulation of everything that was happening at that point, I think I got some divorce back together and all those things. They did affect me because it affected my functionality in terms of time management. That's how I realized I was depressed. I didn't know, yeah, because once I get to work, I'm functional, I'm able to do whatever I'm doing. But I think—
So you escape with your work.
Yes.
And therefore you don't really look at, you know, your feelings. But once you're out of work, then you become more in touch with your emotions.
Yes.
And that's when you pick up that something is amiss, something is not right.
Yes.
You were not the typical depressed type of person that we read about in the books, but you did then go and consult, and it was confirmed.
Yeah, I had such a motor retardation, which means I was slower.
Yeah.
So the main thing that was affected was time.
Yeah.
You know, I'd get my kids ready for school, make sure they're at school on time at 7 o'clock,
yeah,
then go home to get myself ready, but it just was slow, you know.
Yeah.
And that's when I realized, you know, that is something that has all the things that have happened have affected me, and I need to deal with that.
Yes.
And that's why when the first thing that I did when I got out of the divorce court is that I bought a treadmill.
Yeah.
So I have a treadmill in my living room because,
yeah,
I make sure that I don't make an excuse to exercise. For me, that helps with my mood,
yeah,
and to get getting activated for the day.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
and also to be able to watch TDJ, exactly,
yeah,
whatever else I need to watch.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that's,
yeah,
what helped me.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. So
I would like to answer the second part of the question that was asked about Has my brother picked himself up, and how's he doing?
Yes.
He's out latest poetry.
Yes.
He's doing well. When he's on medication, he does very well. He's actually the best uncle. We were with him yesterday.
Yeah.
At home, and he left very late. But
yeah,
although he's living somewhere else separately now, but he's really a very intentional and very present uncle.
Yes.
For my kids. So it's really great having him be part of my kids' life. So
yes,
he's doing well. He's in a good space.
Beautiful, 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 beautiful. So, so Doc, you've got all of this. I mean, I thought I was gonna be able to read maybe at least half of these lessons, 42 of them. Let me just, self-worth, lesson number 37, self-love, lesson number 36, culture and blended families. I'm looking forward to reading that one because it's becoming a reality nowadays. You know, the issue of blended families, resilience, lesson number 30, condemnation, lesson number 27, compassion and giving, lesson number 28, deceitful love and toxic relationships. Let's talk about that one. Let's talk about that one. Lesson number 18. Doc, you've just shared with us that you have just become, what do I call it now? I used to joke when I went through a similar situation that I was a recycled bachelor, all right? So you were, or you are now, a recycled spinster. You are back in the market. Right? So just talk to us, because this is not now past situations that, you know, like childhood, growing up without a parent. This is something recent. The fact that you, unfortunately, your marriage didn't go well to a point where you guys decided to go and dissolve it.
Yes.
But I always say a divorce, there are no winners.
Yeah.
All right. Both parties, if they are honest to themselves, they will always go through a situation, you know, and it may take time for them to recover from that. So in this lesson 18, deceitful love, you know, what are we talking about here?
You know, actually, in going back to what you were saying earlier, in a relationship, I think it's important to also look at how you could have contributed to the breakup, so that it's not a blame situation.
Yeah.
I think, you know, the breakdown happens long before even other people realize it happened.
Yeah.
You know, by the time you announce your divorce, it's long gone.
Yeah.
But actually, what inspired that chapter, I did it like this year, recently. I wrote the book 2019. I added this chapter now because...
Well, it's so relevant. I mean, there are so many relationships that are toxic. That's why we see so much of domestic abuse. We see so much of GBV. So relationships are just going through challenges.
So this is the what inspired this topic is because I was actually doing a presentation for ANC Women's League. Tarasi, who I work with, invited me to be part of the panel with Boba Tabile Dlamini.
Yeah.
So we chose the topic toxic relationships, and that's how I got to write about deceitful love, because about who come to you written toxic.
Yeah.
So it is love, but it's deceitful.
Yeah.
And I think even from, you know, how, and I had to put it at different stages.
It's a wolf in sheep's clothing, you know, and we think it's love.
It's very camouflage, deceitful, you know.
Yeah.
So, for example, as a child, how do perpetrators enter into a child's environment?
Yeah.
It's usually someone they know, like a priest, someone working for the parents,
it's someone they know.
Or a family member, an uncle.
Yeah.
So it's important to start talking about it, because it happens from a very young age.
Yeah.
And it happens with child grooming, where you feel important, or they bribe you. So it's a very subtle, it doesn't come as in you're being hit or physically abused.
Yeah.
It actually comes in a form of what is perceived as love or caring, and it perpetuates the abuse. So yes. Starting from early childhood to even as adults.
All right.
You know.
So one of the people who joined us on this Zoom, Kolega, is saying, what a significant conversation. Congratulations on your book, Doc. It seems like a book worth purchasing. Where can one find it?
Hi, Kolega. Thank you so much for joining us and for your comment. Right now, I'm selling my book through my website. So it's www.drbongiwe.com, all one word.
Yeah.
So through my website, and those who know me personally, I can they can purchase from me personally, but I'm purchasing through my, they can buy through my website.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is a self-published book.
Self-published.
You chose not to go with publishers. You want 100% to come back to you. But then there's a challenge there, you know, because you can only be, you know, in so many places, and you want this book to be bought 24/7, 365 across the world. So at some point, you may need to look at distribution channels beyond your website. But at this point, if somebody wants this book, then they can get it through the website,
www.drbongiwe.com. Yes.
All right. Okay. No, but we will share that information. We'll share that information. All right. So that's deceitful love. Mm. Then there's somewhere where you are talking about letting go.
Mm.
What are you talking about, the dog? It's another lesson about letting go, because have you let go of, you know, the marriage? Now that you guys went to court and it was, you know, there was a decree, but the decree, you know, may not necessarily mean you've let go, and from both parties, by the way. So have you let go at an emotional level? I'm not talking practically, you know, when you are sitting alone, 2 a.m. and you are reflecting, and you said you are a 1 a.m. person. That's the time when you reflect, you are a lack, you know, the people who are morning people like I am, whilst other people are owls who are the evening people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think a lot around 1 a.m., 2 a.m.
Yes.
So when you are alone at that time and looking at this thing that was there called the marriage, have you grieved it properly?
Yes.
Have you let go to say, okay, it's done? Or there's still a part of you that says, maybe a second chance?
Well, you know, I think if you've met someone, I met Paco when I was 19 years old.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's a long history there.
Yeah.
And I think we've just been able to redefine our friendship to our relationship to a friendship. We are very good friends.
Yeah.
Especially for the sake of co-parenting.
Yeah.
So the purpose sent a message.
Yeah.
Well done to the most hardworking and loving mom bombs. My kids are lucky to have you as their mom.
Yes.
Wow.
Well, thanks. That, for me, this is a very beautiful thing, all right? Because whenever people go through a divorce, the majority of the people who go through a divorce, it gets to a point where there's hatred between the parties. It gets to a point where they fight amongst themselves using the kids.
Mm.
So to actually read a message, coming from your former spouse, who's now your friend, a co-parent, and says you are the most hardworking and loving mom, bonks, and my kids are lucky to have you as their mom. Like, I mean,
yes. Wow.
For me, that's important, because we need to grow to a point where if the relationship has failed at a loving level, you as a spouse, as lovers, it must never mean you are now enemies, you know? And certainly, you know, if you fail, and by the way, failure, you know, is when you don't you know, reflect, get up and try again. You know, that's failure.
Yeah.
So, you know, I like the fact that he recognizes your role as the best mom.
And
all right?
and he says that too.
And you know, yeah. That to me yeah. means there's no bad blood between the two of guys. And divorce should never be something that creates enemies.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And the kids never have to choose between the parents, even if they eventually go separate ways and don't interact. But the kids must never, ever have to choose between the parents. So thank you very much, Dr. Pego.
And I mean, and I hope that in the perception chapter, you'll see the picture. It's quite, it's actually about parents like fighting over the child.
Yes.
And I think the way even divorced parents treat each other is a precedence to how the rest of the family is going to treat the other person and how the kids are going to receive the divorce and the separation. So it's very important to still show our kids a very balanced type of family life.
Yeah.
By the way, you also treat each other. They look at how you treat each other.
Yes.
How you treat each other. So that's important.
There's a message from Shogi Lishilo and basically saying, congrats, Doc. Keep up the good work.
Thank you, Shogi. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate the support.
Yeah. All right, so I see another one. You know, I mean, we just don't have enough time to talk about this. But as somebody who has experienced, you know, the issue of divorce and had to go through co-parenting, I'm talking about myself now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of the things that worked for us is the fact that we agreed between ourselves that when it comes to matters of discipline, we must not allow the kid to, you know, play us.
Yes.
We must agree on certain aspects of discipline so that if the kid goes to the other parent because the other one was instilling discipline, you actually talk to the other parent, understand the context, and try and make sure that you've not
united in the decision to make.
Exactly, because when the kid knows that if I go to this parent, they are likely, you know, just to get one up on the other one.
And then manipulate both of you or split you as well.
Exactly, exactly. So the issue of discipline. Now, the other issue, I didn't pick up about this one, but sometimes parents who are no longer together, you find that they've got guilt and they compensate and overcompensate by giving money and other material positions or want to show off the other party by just flooding the kid. When the kid comes back from the weekend from mom, you know, then
overdo
things. Mm. You know, so these are just some of the lessons that are in this book. Mm-hmm. So, Doc, for you, these 42 lessons, which of these lessons would you say, and these are all your kids, 42 lessons, these are your kids, all right? and you're not supposed to choose any, you know, but there must be one that's closest to your heart.
I think wisdom.
Yeah?
Wisdom. Because
lesson number 41.
Wisdom, because it has nothing to do with your qualification or your position in society. It's about really taking your life experiences and learning what you can from them.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's a greater gift than what's in your bank account.
Yeah.
Or the physical things, because the physical things can go, as we've seen COVID.
Yeah.
But I mean that depth of being able to impart, having knowledge and be able to impart to someone else.
Yeah.
I think that's richness at its best.
All right. There's something here that's interesting. Family rivalry. What is that?
You know, I those who can participate, I'd like you to list down, I named them C's. They all start with the C.
Yeah.
10 things that can cause family rivalry. So I went through them in the book.
Yeah.
But family rivalry is basically like things that can cause conflict or conflict, basically family conflict.
Yeah.
And things that can cause family conflict. Some of the C's is competition, coveting, which is means being envious of someone else. So we're all faced with certain family conflicts, and that's why.
Yeah, you talk about the 10 C's here, competition,
yes,
or comparing,
yes,
coveting, that is to yearn to possess that which belongs to the other,
yes,
camouflage, which is pretending to be someone you are not, controlling, condemning, showing strong disapproval or judging somebody, contempt, that is the feeling that a person is worthless or beneath consideration, communication, conflict of interest, too comfortable, and being correct, always right.
Yes.
And it takes courage to speak the truth and not sweep things under the carpet.
Correct.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously, again, this is another biggie. You know,
yes,
this is another biggie. So one can just read one lesson per day. It will take you 42 days, you know, to actually finish this book by just reading one.
Yes.
You know,
yes,
and just reflect on that one lesson, you know.
Mm. Or even 1 week.
Yes, you can even do one a week, then there's 52 weeks in a year. So you will still have another 10 weeks to go back and reflect on 10 others.
Yes, that's why it would be good for life orientation in schools.
Yes.
Because they can focus on a lesson a week.
Yes.
You know, so, and start reflecting, because it's about not just reading,
yeah,
but reflecting and see how it relates to your life, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now, Doc, at the beginning of the first lesson, right? At the beginning of the first lesson, which is being authentic.
Yes.
There's somewhere where you're quoting, I'm not sure if this is the beginning of that, the quotation at the beginning of the intro,
yes,
right, the purpose, you quoted from one of the songs from Whitney Houston, right, The Greatest Love of All, and you quoted the part that says, I believe the children are our future, teach them well, and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside. Now, this to me was very clear. That's why you are choosing and saying the primary target of this book is the kids. Just talk to us about this. You know, this quotation, this song, you know, what does it do to you, or what did it do to you for it to actually be the first quotation in your book?
I think it kind of reminds me of boarding school, like, which is one of the highlights of my life.
Yeah.
And how we were taught to be, you know, self-efficacy, you know, to be able to trust your own decisions, make your own decisions, be independent.
Yeah.
So it reminds me a lot of my junior of St. Dominican Convent, and people were influential at that time, like Sister Ignatius and Sister Natalie,
yeah,
you know, who became our mothers. You see how so you can adopt anyone to be,
yes,
to be a role model or your mom. So and I think I am who I am because of all the people I've adopted in my life, even T.D. Jakes, who doesn't even know me, far away.
Yes.
So it's just about role models and how, and the impact that they have on making someone, a child, believe in themselves and love themselves.
Yes.
And that's what this is all about. Which, can I please just acknowledge the
yeah,
children?
Yeah.
Can I, so the children on the cover of my book is my children, Nkweti Dlailani and Temani Dlailani.
Where are they?
So here is Nkweti.
The one in the orange.
Yes, in the red, in the orange t-shirt is Nkweti Dlailani, Temani Dlailani with the tutu skirt.
Yeah.
And then we actually asked his friends to be part of the photo shoot. So this is very personal because it's when they are grown up, it will be his friends who are part of this.
Yeah.
So his friends who are in from Kretsch is Khalib, and Khalib is there with his sister Yanette. It's also showing to you know, a family dynamic going on there. And then there's also from Kretsch is also Willow, who's a very close friend of Nkweti. And then from currently at his school right now, his best friends are Jibran,
yeah,
and also Kushiel. to share his day with his sister, Jandi. So, and my photographer's daughter is also there. Kaylin de Villas is also there. So I think it really adds a personal touch to it, because it's children we know that he always hangs around with. So it's really awesome. Thank you for being part of this project, for everyone who's been part of it, like the photographer Elani, to the illustrator Marilise, especially the illustrator of the book Just Be Authentic. Got beautiful bee illustrations, to Bonita, who I love the layout, because the layout is almost like magazine style.
Yes.
So it's different and it's funky, and it reaches the youth, the teenagers. And also to Judy, who is a website developer and has helped me just finish this and get these posts out and the music videos that I send her, and she's able to incorporate everything in.
Yeah.
And to Ryan Sweetlove, who was doing the proofreading, but also helped a lot in the editing of the book.
Beautiful.
And to the person who takes my daily photos, Sis Damianto, who was at 1 minute to hospital.
Yeah.
He's working at the COVID tent, but before we start the day, before walking to the hospital, I'm like, please, can we take a few photos? So,
yeah.
You know, everyone who has contributed to being.
You sound like you're
I'm grateful.
you sound like you've just got an Oscar. My producer, my photographers, you know, all of these people. You know, now I've just sent a direct message to Dade Pepo. You know, I just wanted him to switch his camera and unmute. You know, I loved his message, and I would love if he doesn't mind, you know, to just switch on his camera and, unmute. Dade Pepo, are you up for that?
Good afternoon.
Hey, Linda.
I'm good. I'm just in bed. I had a terrible day last night. I was working until 11 at night.
Yes.
I had a call. I was called out to the hospital again at 3 a.m. So yes. I've been in bed.
Yes, you see now, the upside or the downside of that Hippocratic oath. It messes up with your routine, man. But anyway, yes. I just thought, Dr. B more than all of us, and she has just come up with this creative, project that is meant to make life better for others. You know, I would like to hear more from you just about the project and the person she is. I know you did say she's the best mom, but, you know. That.
Mm. Well, yeah, like you said, I've known her since, like you said, since 2000.
Yeah.
I bought her first book, I think, that year to write her thoughts in it. Mm. So basically what she's told you about her life, it's absolutely true. She's always been a thoughtful person. I remember the day she worked at CNA in Fourways.
Yeah,
and picking her up there after work and things like that. Yeah, and she's a great mom, and she's not doing this for herself, by the way.
Yes, yes.
She's not doing it for herself. No, but she could have easily stuck into her own academic stuff, and and then life goes on. But I'm very proud of her that she's juggling the book, her studies, patient care. I mean, who does obstetrics and then decides to do psychiatry? I always tell her that I think she's not.
I'm confused between the heart and the mind.
Exactly, who does that? I mean, even my daughter sometimes gets confused. Say, Daddy, does mommy bring babies to earth? Because she tells me she brings babies to earth. I say, yeah, she does that. And she looks at me puzzled. And she asked me, Daddy, what do you do?
you have the doctor that makes people sleep before the babies come out.
So I'm really an underperformer.
Oh, no. You see, that's humility at its best. You know, but anyway, thank you very much, Dr. Teko.
Thank you.
Thank you for the support that you're giving to her. The fact that you guys, if we go to Home Affairs, we'll see a different status, does not mean you guys cannot collaborate. You know, I mean, you've got kids, you've got so many things that you had planned, together. You guys follow your dreams and collaborate where you can and make sure that those kids grow up balanced without having to choose between mom and dad because they love both.
That's important.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Sure.
Yeah. And also thank you to the grandparents. I was able to drop off my kids at the grandparents before I came here. So, you know, it really takes a village to raise kids. So I'm grateful for the family as well. I'm grateful to their schools.
Yes.
Works Waterproof House Preparatory School and DSG Pretoria.
Yes.
They're great schools. And I think it helps that you can leave your children and be happy that even if you're working, they're okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, Doc. Mm-hmm. Just type the email address. Sorry, the website. I think it's important for those who are in the Zoom. She's typing the website where people can go and get, you know, this book. But otherwise, she can also an email. Can also be sent to her and she can make a plan. So she's just gonna write now the email address, but for those who are not on Zoom, it's www.drbongiwetlaelane, that is TLAILANE.com. So if you go to www.drbongiwetlaelane, TLAILANE.com, you'll be able to get her, to sort you out with this book. Honestly, I think it's a life skills book. It's a kind of book that in all schools should actually be part of life orientation because it's real. It deals with real issues. And there's so many people out there, you know, single moms where the fathers, MIA from long time ago, missing in action from long time ago. And this is the kind of book that can help you to supplement, as part of your parenting. And this is a book that can be used by basically anybody. So I really encourage people to make contact with Dr. Bongiwe Tailane. I call her Dr. B. And she happens to also like the insect, the bee. She always has that in her post, but honestly, we live in a world that is challenging and we need as much help as we can. And this book will be one of those books that you will never regret getting it. How much is it though?
So it's $350.
Yeah. All right.
On my website.
Yes.
But that excludes the
courier fees. Yeah. Yes. All right.
So if you know me personally, it's actually better to get it from me. I do deliver to some children in Pretoria.
Yeah. But you see, Doc, must think big. Right? Must think big. This is a book that must be able to be bought by people from across the country and also beyond the country. So it needs to be, you know, people must know that the actual book is $350, but there are shipping costs. Over and above that. But, you know, an investment of $350 for something that is life-changing, like the content of this book, I think it's a small investment to pay. It's not even the price of a Moe when you go to Mapro, you know? So,
exactly. It's for life.
Yes.
Mm.
Kalib Ayana says, congrats for me, proud of you.
Oh, she's okay, thank you. Thank you.
All right, so guys, I think at this point we are going to close. Mm-hmm. It's been a very good 1 hour, 45 minutes.
Wow, that's
of chatting about that's the investment in just talking about your book, and we only just scratched the surface. We just dealt with about five of the lessons, and there's 42.
Thanks for the
question. All right, yeah. So those others that we have not spoken about, or even the ones we've spoken about, you know, we just
scripted.
Yeah, you know, so if you want the depth of each of the 42 lessons that Dr. B is bringing to you, please make you know, a plan to get the book. This recording will also be available on the Dr. Fundi YouTube channel. I'll actually send it to her, you know, at the end of this show now, and then she can be able to send it via WhatsApp.
Okay.
Or email to anybody who could not be, you know, on this show.
Okay, thank
so,
you.
Doc, congratulations and well done.
Thank you, Dr.
We will continue to talk. As I was reading the book, I think there's many other areas we can talk about to enrich that vision of what God has brought you over and above what you already have acquired academically.
Thank you so much.
All right, so thank you very much, Doc, and all the best from us here at Dr. Fundi.
Thank you so much, Dr. Fundi.
Thank you
for this opportunity.
All right. thank you to everybody who joined us. We really appreciate your time. It's a Sunday, it's a long weekend. You could have chosen to do anything else, but you chose to be with us, and I hope I managed to interest you enough by asking the right questions and allowing Dr. B to be able to share, so that after this show, you can make contact with her so that you can get the book. It's an investment that you will not regret. So thank you very much to everybody. We appreciate your time. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you, bye.
Bye.